the funding of William Campbell. At the time, there were lots of boarding houses, which were the primary way for people to stay when they were visiting Boise, as well as a number of saloons that were attached to hotels. They were so large they could accommodate hundreds of mining and railroad workers at the time, which didn't have the best hygiene habits, so it wasn't always the cleanliest place to stay. And so William Campbell saw the opportunity to open a boutique hotel when more and more people were visiting out west on the Transcontinental Railroad. In the late 1800s, he took a trip from Boise to New York City. He stopped in every small town that he could, going boutique hotel to boutique hotel, to decide exactly which style hotel he wanted to settle in. He settled on French Chateau style, or downtown Disneyland style, as I like to call it. Well, it looks just like Main Street USA to me. But he was so inspired by that French Chateau style that he opened a building to remember in Boise. It really set the architectural precedent moving forward, and as we walk around on the tour today, you can see other buildings with the same inspired look of those turrets. The Eiffel Tower has these three turrets. It's complete with a unique plum trim, and it stands out so much today. You can imagine how much it stood out over 100 years ago. Still standing today, initially upon completion, it was the tallest building in Boise, and you can see the reflection across the street there in the building. It's almost a little easier to see than it is from our perspective right now. There's a third turret around on the other side. But there was a huge draw for many other reasons besides just the architecture of the Eisenhower. It was a huge musical hub for more than 50 years. So it was a jazz hub, and jazz musicians and followers alike traveled from all over the world to participate in one of the musical performances here at the Eisenhower. Gene Kelly himself used to play in the lobby, where he trained one of the Curtis Stigers, a modern-day jazz band that still tours around. And in fact, just this weekend is the Gene Harris Jazz Music Festival going on all around Boise. 10th Street Station is an entrance in the basement bar on the side here, and they're still known to hold musical performances to this day. They were a location for many of those musical performances in days past. The Eisenhower also has its fair share of ghost stories, being an old building as it is, and the number of wealthy visitors that came and stayed in the Eisenhower. It's rumored that King of the Hill was written while that musician was staying in the historic Eisenhower Hotel. And it also was home to the first elevator in Idaho, so people came from all over just to ride the elevator. can anyone guess the project cost of this building back in 1900? Of King Tut's tomb in 1922. And in the 20s, we do see a huge outbreak of Egyptian theaters being built all across the country. It really became a fad. Leo Falk and his brother owned a number of downtown grocery stores at that time in Boise, and they also owned a number of other businesses, which they were hoping to increase business at. So in order to receive more business and foot traffic inside their grocery store, they decided to build an Egyptian theater. It was also an opportunity to change the culture of downtown, which at the time mostly contained large business locations and bars. So this was a family-friendly activity. When they did build it, the movies that were being released were silent films that were black and white. And so this location was built for acoustics. Because the acoustics are so good in the auditorium of the Egyptian Theater, which holds over 1,200 seats, Opera Idaho does all of their performances at the Egyptian Theater. There are still prominent concerts that perform at this venue to this day, as well as movie nights, twice a week, classic movie nights, which are always a costume contest for the characters in the movie. They also coincide with holidays throughout the year, so they've got some Halloween ones in October and Christmas ones in December. I encourage you to go inside and look around anytime you can. The muraling inside is very exquisite, and it's open to the public during the day on weekdays. Weekends, you're likely to see film festivals, like BMX-type film festivals or backcountry skiing film festivals. Most recently, last month, I went to the Le Bois Film Festival at Conservation. Boise, 6th of May. The building behind me, the Pioneer Tent and Awning Building with the white horse on top, Pioneer Tent and Awning Company operated there for more than 60 years. Old-fashioned REI. So they sell canvas, sporting goods, all kinds of tools. Those are the original advertisements above the Jimmy John sign there. It's actually one of my favorite places to go in and kill time downtown. If you're ever in the area looking for some time to kill, you can enter under the awning and it's like an antique mall on the inside. There's carriages, phone booths, a few hundred cigarette boxes dating back a couple hundred years, which is somewhat interesting. Yes, that's called Idaho Made, so it's all made in Idaho. There's also old wanted posters and like advertisements for the Pony Express even in Boise, back behind the P.O. boxes. Those are really funny. I love looking through and reading all of them. They're like, must be willing to risk death daily. Orphans preferred. Behind you guys here, this is the Idaho Statesman Building. It has a plaque commemorating the first computer in Boise, which was over 3,000 pounds for only 400 digits of information. The Idaho Statesman did occupy this building for more than 40 years. Right next to it, we'll get a slightly better shot from across the street, but the telephone building. Now, Boise did not have the first telephone service in Idaho. That distinction goes to Haley, Idaho, so congrats, Haley. But we did want to have the biggest and the best. So they designed a building just for the telephone operations. They designed it so that the cables of the telephones could be on the main level, and the telephone operators could each sit nicely in one of the windows upstairs so that people who were traveling through town could admire them from afar. Looks like a fire station here. They did have to rebuild it after the previous fire station ironically burned down in a fire. After it did burn down, they rebuilt beginning in 1902, finished it in 1903, hence the timestamp there. Now, I don't know if they have a lease agreement, but I just find it way too ironic that the melting pot is inside the fire station. It was the first location to have full-time paid firefighters. It does look nearly identical to how it did when it was first built, with one exception. So the entryway underneath the melting pot sign is squared out now. Although originally when it was built in 1902, it was this exquisite Romanian archway. And that's because they were operating fire trucks without trucks. They were horse and carriage mounted. So as soon as fire trucks got invented, they had to square out the opening there so that the trucks could fit through. Other than that, looks nearly identical. So these are traffic signals. These are traffic signal control boxes. And with the Mayor's Reallocation Fund and the Arts and History Foundation, they've been able to establish a stipend fund so that local artists could be employed to design these traffic boxes. They have a special debut ceremony for friends and family. A little splash right here. I wanted to point these out. So you can see these all around downtown, most of the buildings. That means that even the buildings like this one that were built as early as 1901 had pre-established geothermal heating. On Warm Springs Avenue here in Idaho was the first place to discover geothermal heating, and officially the first commercial location to have it. It still exists to this day, but was originally a much more castle-like structure, and that's the Natatorium. It did collapse after just a couple of years of being open. You can see these all around downtown. Almost all of the downtown buildings Union block building, and this rock was built, it's local sandstone that's pulled from Table Rock.